I recognize the fact that you had a great deal of experience in that you wrote this book. And of course, it gives me great satisfaction to know that I had a little part in this book. And it pleases me that the Lord has given me the opportunity to do something to contribute to his work on earth. And you mentioned some time ago that your book was being, there was a request to publish your book in another country. Could you tell us about that?
Oh, yes. I was surprised and delighted in receiving a letter on March the 17th of 84, this year, from our publishing house in Switzerland. And the general manager, Alfred Burkhardt, mentioned about the fact that the publishing committee would like to publish the book in the German language. I'd like to read you a few lines of this letter, if I may.
I'd like to have you read the whole letter.
Well, it says, March 2, 1984, a tribute to the supernatural, dear Brother Morneau. We are very interested in publishing your fine book, A Tribute to the Supernatural, in German language. The Administrative Committee of Review and Herald Publishing Association in Eggerstown gave us already the permission. And Brother Robert J. Kinney, the manager of the book department, wanted us to work out with a royalty arrangement. Therefore, we beg you to inform us about the conditions you grant us. We would be very glad to have a minimal royalty rate in order to be able to fix a low price and to ensure the book a wide distribution. Looking forward to hear from you soon. I remain, dear Brother Morneau, yours very cordially in Christ, Alfred Burkhardt, manager. Then he says, P.S. Could you send us a photo of you yourself? We intend to print it on the back of the book together with some biographical facts. And I was deeply impressed with the fact that they wanted to have a study and conversion experience published in German. And the wife and I prayed about this and decided that we were not going to ask for any royalty. We would like to help the cause of the Lord honored. I'm not a writer in the full sense of the word. I make my living at it. And I feel that I'd like to help the brethren to bring the Word of God as it was presented to me in 1946 by you and your wife, the beautiful Bible studies that we covered, and how I was shown eternal realities and the way they truly are. And we wrote back immediately, sent them photos of myself, and I received a lovely letter again on the, the 3rd of the following month, which was April, from, again, Brother Alfred Burkhardt, manager, says, dear Brother Morneau, you may realize how great the pleasure is to read in your kind letter of March 14, 1984, that you grant us the permission to translate and print your book, A Trip into the Supernatural, in German language, and that you give us all claims to place a royalty, and that you give up all claims. Thank you very much for this privilege, which is really an important help for us. Our chief editor, Brother Gustav Tobler, Junior, has already finished the rough translation of the book, and we hope to print it at the latest in autumn of this year. We shall be very glad to send you the 6 copies wanted as soon as the book comes off the press. I asked them to give me only 6 copies as a, something to remember the goodness of the Lord, yes, in blessing our lives and the lives of others. Many thanks also to the for the 2 fine photos. We are planning to place your picture on the back of the cover. Thank you once more for your great kindness, dear Brother Morneau. I beg you to give the best greetings also to your wife and your children. May the Lord bless you all abundantly. Yours very cordially in Christ, Alfred Burkhardt, manager. And I'm really delighted. The Elder is also very happy over the fact that the Word of God will be presented in the way that it was presented to me a few decades ago. And this is a great, great, wonderful experience for us.
You know, what really is wonderful, Roger, is that my own experience was really enhanced by your experience, in that while I was just a babe, so to speak, spiritually, coming into the message, I had one question in my mind those years ago when I asked myself, is it possible that I should stop going to church on Sunday and go to church on Saturday? And I asked the Lord, Lord, if this is right, and I should give up Sunday and go to church on Saturday, let me win one soul. And you know, the amazing thing is that without even knowing that God would answer that prayer, the prayer was answered almost immediately. And the amazing thing is that you were someplace else, and you were so deeply involved in spiritism that your soul was in jeopardy. And you realized your situation, and you and some other part of the Montreal asked the Lord, if there is a God, help me.
Yeah.
And the mighty arm of God stretched out and brought the two of us together. Well, to make a long story short, we know, we realized that you had been converted, and I was baptized, and we were both baptized in Montreal. But years later, when after we met again and we made plans to put this book together, and you to write it and me to read it and have it typed, when I finally got that manuscript in my hand, it was completed, all ready to mail back to you. The only thing that I could do, as I drove down the freeway from Miriam Harper's house, and Miriam Harper is a typist, was to drive the car, and tears of joy coming down my face. If anyone could have seen me, they would have thought, boy, there's something wrong with that guy. He's driving his car to cry. But I don't know if anyone can understand the joy that comes from serving the Lord. When you realize that you've done something for the Lord that the Lord wanted you to do, when you realize that after all the mistakes you've made in life, you've actually done something and started something for the Lord, and you've completed that something for the Lord, the joy that comes is unspeakable.
Right.
And we have been talking about demon spirits, but there's no words that we can say enough for the great Holy Spirit of God.
That's right.
And the work that can be accomplished if we just serve the Lord, ask for a portion of His Holy Spirit to guide us, and if we follow the pleadings of the Spirit, great things can be done.
Right.
And I would really admonish anybody who looks at this tape to get this book. Here you can see it well, I'll put it a little closer. Trip into the Supernatural by Roger Morneau. And you will enjoy the wonderful message in this book. In order for this book to be published, Roger, our ministers had to read this book quite extensively, didn't they?
Oh yes, as I was told, it was read by a reading committee, a publishing house, and then it went before a special committee of journal conference that was studying at a time the matter of spiritual warfare, and they understood that the experience was truly mighty hand of God working in my life, a miracle of salvation. In that the Bible studies, the way that they have been given, the way they have been received on my part, and the mysteries of the Catholic Church, and that which had led me away from God, was explained so clearly and truly that they were anxious to make the book in a format that would be easy for people to acquire. See, the manuscript is almost 300 pages, and they would have made it to a hardcover book, would have sold probably for about $14. So the publishing committee of Brigham Herald asked me if it would be okay with me to trim it down to 125 pages. It would be really to the point. Everything would be well set in a way that people could read the book in about 3 hours,
yes,
in one sitting. And I've had a number of people telling me they read the book in one sitting.
Do you think it's possible you think it's possible that this book might eventually be published again in the complete form?
Well, I don't think that it would be published that way, but from all of the inquiries I received from people and all of the questions they've asked, I'll probably, before long, write another book, which would also carry some of the portions that have not been put in there.
Yes.
And as I explain to people, and I find by experience the book has come out, that even Seventh Adventists do not understand the supernatural, the warfare that's going on behind the scene, as the really shouldn't, but God would have them. Spirit prophecy tells us in testimonies that we do not understand as we should the great conflict going on between invisible agencies, the controversy between loyal and disloyal angels. As the servant of the Lord says, over every man, good and evil angels strives. And it rests with us to determine who shall win. And she goes on saying that we are to find our strength where the early disciples found theirs in prayer and supplication. So and there are so many things that people have asked me about in regards to helping people that are distressed and perplexed and oppressed by demon spirits that I'll probably have to write another book before long that will might be, you know, more intensive than what you have here in regards to the whole conflict.
One thing I must say, Roger, is that in reading the entire manuscript and reading the book itself, I can't really say that anything has been left out. The way the book is put together, it's so complete that the entire message that was conveyed in the entire manuscript is conveyed here.
Right.
There are some subtleties, as we discussed here, that should be brought out in the future because, as you said, many Adventists and other Christians are not aware of the fact that they play the key role in this great controversy.
That's right.
And although the battle is raging all around us, we are the key. Because we are the ones for whom Christ died.
Right. You see, the big issue at stake is the control of the minds of men, either by the forces of good or the forces of evil. In the early 1700s, according to leading spiritists, Satan and his spirit counselors, which is often referred to by spiritists as the gods, because they worship them, held a great general council. And the whole idea was to prepare for that great scientific age that was soon to break upon the world. 3 points were brought out by the end of, when the council had come to an end, a three-part policy had been adopted, according to the satanist priest now. First, they were to establish a belief among humans that Satan and his angels do not really exist. That was one purpose. Also, the second part was intended to achieve total mind control over humans by taking hypnotism out of the realm of the occult and introduce it as the new science for the benefit of mankind.
What you say here, that a person who submits to hypnotism is right. Really putting himself under the power of the evil.
Definitely, no question about it. And the spirits knew that in order for the spirit, you know, for the minds, for the spirits to take total control of some great minds, they had to bring hypnotism out of the realm of the occult and present it as a new science for the benefit of mankind. So just to enlarge a little bit upon this, a few years later, the spirits decided that an Austrian physician by the name of Franz Mesmer would be the individual that he would use to accomplish a transition. Mesmer believed, in reality, that a mysterious fluid penetrates the human body. And he brought about a theory called animal magnetism, later named Mesmerism. Now, Mesmer believed that that certain persons were endowed with this mysterious fluid in such a way that it would give them power to overrule the mind of others and even place them into a trance. And by the time that he died in 1815, the use of hypnotism as a means of anesthesia was beginning to acquire an aura of respectability among many great physicians in Europe. And that was the beginning of it. Now, you know about Charles Darwin and Thomas Henry Huxley?
Right.
Now, it happened that at that time, the theory of evolution was brought about by Darwin, who was born in 1809. Huxley was born in 1825. Now, the spirits, when the youngsters were very young, had medical doctors use hypnotism on them as a means of anesthesia. At that time, the spirits determined that those youngsters should become, in adulthood, instrumental in establishing the greatest system of religion ever to take place on the face of planet Earth. It would become the greatest because it would become integrated into that great outpouring of scientific knowledge that was soon to break upon the world. And demon spirits determined that it would engulf people from all religious convictions as well as the irreligious. And that system of theirs could not be classified as a religious doctrine. It would become known as the theory of evolution. Mm-hmm. Now, while the apparently spiritists, the leading spiritists that I was affiliated with, while the spiritists intended that Darwin's theory should contradict the word of God, the main purpose of it was to open the way for establishing Thomas Henry Huxley's powerful teachings that man is a direct descendant of apes. Now, here's what the spirits determined that this would do. The spirits say that anybody that believes in the theory automatically destroys in himself belief in the book of Genesis concerning the account of creation, yes, the fall of man, and redemption. And by believing in the teachings of Thomas Henry Huxley, that man is a direct descendant of apes, the spirits would cause people believing that to commit a great abomination before the Creator God.
Of course, it's an insult to God.
The spirits recognize the life giver as the Creator God. They recognize that. And they felt that if anybody could be led to believe that we are descendants from apes, the fact that they believe this way is a great insult to the Creator God. And by that fact, they commit a great abomination, which disqualifies them from being members of Christ's kingdom. Not something?
And that puts a man in the same, in the category with the spirit, the evil spirit.
That's right, definitely. Yeah, definitely.
Today in our schools, it's expected that this evolutionary theory should be taught to all the children, mm-hmm, young people. And it's a pity that many of the people who send their children to the public school system are not aware of the fact that they're exposing their children to this kind of theory.
That's right. It's a religious system. The spirits have considered it a religious system. And the reason for writing the book at this time is the fact that we're living in an age where people have lost the capacity to detect evil in its infancy. You take the entertainment world, is plagued today with people that are determined to deface the image of God and man. They are completely demon-inspired and demon-controlled. And the rock artists, all those people, as you set your affection upon their music, you're setting your affections away from Christ. When you set your affections away from Christ, you become a follower of someone else, whether you believe it or not. And this is the way that the spirits are determined that they're going to cause millions of young people to disqualify themselves being members of Christ's coming kingdom. So I believe that the book will help people meet the service for Christ.
Roger, before we finish with this taping, I'd like to ask you to do one favor. Give us a little bit of your background, your family life, and where you grew up, so the people who haven't read the book yet will know who Roger Morneau is and where he came from. I realize that you came from a place that's only a few hundred miles from where I was born. But the people looking at the tape may not know that.
Yeah. I was born in Eastern Canada, in Saint-Jean, New Brunswick, from a highly Catholic family, French-speaking Catholic family. On my father's side of the family, two of his sisters were nuns, and one of his brother was a priest who became Monseigneur of the Roman Catholic Church.
What kind of rank is a Monseigneur?
Monseigneur is before the cardinals, you know. Didn't be cardinal.
So he was pretty high up?
Yeah, he was pretty high up there. And when I was 12 years old, my mother died. Of course, they intended that I should be a priest. So from the time I was a little father, I started to memorize the catechism. Versus, you know, the questions and answers with catechism every day. By the time I was 7 years old, I memorized one catechism of about 75 pages. and made a first communion. But when I was 12 years old, I memorized 2 or 3 catechisms that amounted to about maybe another 150 to 200 pages.
How many catechisms are there, by the way?
Oh, they can rank into some pretty sophisticated catechisms, depending on the age of the person that studies the doctrines of the Catholic Church. And my mother died when I was 12 years old, and I could not adjust to the fact that a good God, a God of love, would allow the misery and the distress that was going on kind of her to continue. And I felt that God wasn't deserving of my respect and worship, and I kind of at times determined I was going to go to church, he's my father, but when I would be on my own later on, I would never have to do anything to do at all with God. So during World War II, I was in the Merchant Navy, had many, many close calls with death, and many of the men that I knew perished at sea. Mm-hmm. After coming out of the service, I was going to take a trade in Montreal. Meanwhile, I took a job in a billiard and bowling alley operation, one of the fine spots in Montreal. And one day, one of my old sailing buddies came walking in there. And I was surprised to see him. I was surprised to see that he was still alive. And that evening, we had dinner together. We talked about many things. And he informed me that he was a very fortunate young man and that he had become acquainted with folks that talked with the spirits of departed loved ones. To cut a long story short, I was invited to one of their meetings. And of course, I was almost terrified for the first time. But it grows on you after a while. I found real comfort in talking with the spirits, conversing with the spirits, which I thought were the spirits of the dead. A while later, one of the people that I met at one of the seances was a spiritist. He worshipped spirits and understood that the spirits that were talking or imitating the voice or the form of the apparition that we were conversing with were the spirits of even were these. In fact, demon spirits and not the departed soul of some persons we knew previously. I was involved in spirit worship for a while and became to the point where they wanted to initiate me to the cult. And at that time, I just could not see myself being initiated in the secret society. Now I knew that the spirits, nobody ever came to this secret society unless the satanic priests or some other people, the leaders, were told by a spirit that a certain person should be invited to, that he should first of all associate with a certain individual for a time, and then he should be invited to their meetings and to be acquainted with the real world spirits, as it is. See, the spirits that I associated with recognize Satan and his angels as super beautiful beings, super intelligent, and they worship them. And it was quite an experience. And in the worship room of the gods, there must have been about 75 or more paintings, beautiful paintings, about 30 inches wide, 48 inches high. We were told, when I asked the Spanish priest, what are the majestic looking beings that you have on those paintings, and he says they are the gods that we have been talking about on the testimonial sessions on the first floor. And I asked him, who are they? And he told me that they were demon spirits that had materialized, were photographed, and then they made paintings out of them. And they were super intelligent looking beings, and it was quite an experience.
Now, of course, these demon spirits that materialized could, even though they look beautiful in the pictures, they could have been lying about their looks, because they can appear as anyone they wish. Isn't that true?
Yes, but the Satanist priest said that he saw a spirit, a demon spirit appear to him. It was a beautiful, bright angel. And actually told him that it was in Chicago. He wasn't in a hotel in Chicago, in his suite, and this bright, beautiful being appeared to him and told him that to call Montreal immediately, because the person that he had left in charge was about to destroy all the work that the spirits had done to bring my friend and I to the secret society, and that I should be allowed to go with George to one of their meetings. And the idea that they materialized because of the fact that humans cannot look upon themselves and live without being blinded or, lose their sight or have their sights completely, or maybe have lose their sight another sight. So the spirits actually materialized and were photographed. So I have no way measuring pros and cons. I don't even want to mention you even giving a thought to might be different or anything. So when I was faced with the idea that they wanted me to be initiated on the 1st of November of 1946, my friend says, yes, I'll go through that. And I told the students, please, I could not do this until the following week. And I went home that night, went to bed, and I couldn't sleep. And about 2 o'clock in the morning, as I said to my, in my perplexed state of mind, I said, if there's a God in heaven that cares for me, help me. And that's the prayer, the shortest prayer I've ever prayed, I can assure you. And it was not really meant as a prayer as such. It was just the result of a terrible, terrible sense of doom or something happening to me in the very near future. And I uttered this as a cry of help. Anybody that's drowning will cry for some help. Even if they didn't, you didn't like the one that's sending the ocean forever, if he's drowning, he will call for help. You know?
So, well, yeah, that's what prayer was, certainly answered. Yeah.
So in a few days I met you, and we had Bible studies, 28 Bible studies in 1 week, and I started to give the Bible Sabbath, the first Saturday. And a few months later I was baptized in the Commandment Keeping Church.
I suppose the readers of this book will be surprised to hear that you received these Bible studies from an Adventist who wasn't really an Adventist yet.
Yeah, but your wife was a good Adventist. And she knew the studies that she was getting.
And well, I got the studies myself, and I was able to read them, interpret them, because Ellen Taylor had given me the Bible studies previously, and although mine were simplified, they were still very complete. And we certainly had a wonderful time giving those Bible studies. And your dedication and your conversion was also instrumental in making me firm. So it looks like, you were responsible for helping me to become a stronger Christian, while I was responsible for helping you to see the difference between what you believed at the time and the truth. So it looks like God has a wonderful, mysterious way of working with men.
Right.
It's a long battle. And since we were very young at the time, I would like to remind the young people who look at this tape that God has a wonderful way of working with young people.
That's right. There's so much at stake.
Yeah.
When I think of it, eternal life would be 100 million years of just fantastic living. And that'll be just the beginning of good things.
You imagine 100 million years of being young.
That's right.
Being as vibrant and strong and not having to worry about being tired from walking up a hill.
The idea of going to foreign worlds and you know, being able to see something new and different every day.
Mm-hmm.
Then coming back to Europe being new and being able to have our own homes and do our own thing if you like to call it that way.
And think about no taxes, no worrying about bills,
no distresses that we
no stress. You don't have to worry about walking down the street and someone mugging you.
That's right.
You don't have to worry about getting into a car to go from one place to another. You'll have your transportation.
You don't have to worry about cars breaking down the flags.
That's right.
Staff Arizona.
Yes, we had a few days ago, and it cost of over $700.
Yeah.
And you know, I wonder why there are so many people who are perplexed, and particularly who are wonder about our own Seventh-day Adventist people, and even some other Christians who are not Adventists, but they seem to be so perplexed, and they don't know which way to turn. I can't understand how we can look at that Bible day after day.
Well, you see, once a person becomes a Christian, it is just the beginning of difficulties.
That is true.
In reality. Because the spirits will not distress and perplex people's lives as long as they know that eternal life is a certainty that they're going to be in their camp, you see, and be destroyed. Once you become a Christian, then they want to try to make it as hard as possible to be a Christian, as hard as possible and unpleasant as possible to keep God's holy precepts. And unless we dedicate our lives every morning and thank the Lord every day as we go along and before going to bed at night, give a prayer of thanksgiving for the grace received during that day, it's not possible to have the strength between you. And the strength is in Christ and the power of the Spirit.
So what you're saying now is something that we should all understand, and that is prayer is the key.
That's right.
It's the key to peace. It's the key to your salvation.
That's right.
It's the key to increasing your faith.
Yeah.
And it is indeed the key to eternal life.
Yeah. You see, over the years, I have tried to school myself into deepening my dependence upon the merits of the blood of Christ. Mm-hmm. I have found over the years that I have been able to do this by every morning reading the 27th chapter of Matthew from verse 24 to 54, mm-hmm. every day without fail. That is the chapter of the crucifixion. And by having done this, I have learned to realize the value of that infinite sacrifice, that the Lord of glory, second person of the Godhead, who spoke into existence all that we see today and all that we will see through the eternal ages, was willing to take upon himself our redemption, to come to earth, to suffer and to die. And when you read this chapter daily and you meditate upon it, so you meditate upon it as you drive down the road, as you work at your machine or something, it does something to you. It does something for you.
Matthew 27.
Matthew 27 chapter, verses 24 to 54.
Oh, 24 to 54.
24 through 54. And to me, it's been a beautiful, beautiful solidifying of my walk with Christ. And when I have time, usually I also read the last chapter of Matthew on the resurrection, which is very beautiful. But those verses 24 to 54, I do every morning. And this has been my way to solidify my strength depends upon Christ for my salvation, for victory over self, over sin, over the world, and over the power of fallen angels.
I'd like to say to the young people who are looking at this tape that you might think that worshiping the devil is a terrible thing. But I'd like to add that your soul can be lost, just as lost, just as completely. If you get up there and dance for him, you're dancing to Michael Jackson, or with Michael Jackson. Your soul can be just as lost if you are just telling little lies. Your soul can be just as lost if you steal, whether it's little things or big things. So don't think that because you're not worshiping the devil or communicating with demons or doing those spiritual things that are an abomination to the Lord, that these are the only things that can get you in a lost condition. Being lost means simply not doing God's will. The devil is just as pleased, and I'm sure you'd agree with Roger, if we just don't study our Bibles. The devil is just as pleased if we don't get on our knees and pray every day. The devil is just as pleased if we don't study our lesson. And he's very happy if we don't go to Sabbath school.
Yeah, because we can't fortify ourselves in that which we need to resist the evil.
It's like building a 100-story building and you don't use any steel in it. Just use clay. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen to the building when it rains? In our life, we have rainstorms. We call them trials.
How's your tape running?
Oh, that tape is running fine. It's good for 6 hours.
It is.
That tape doesn't. The reason the other tape finished was because I only had about a few minutes left on it. But this tape will run for 6 hours.
Oh, my goodness. Well, Cyril, I think we ought to close shop for the night and go to bed because I need to get
well,
in the morning.
To those who are looking at the tape, I have to say, it is 11:01 on the clock, and We did have a wonderful time discussing Roger's book, Trip into the Supernatural. We are in my home on 19019 Northwood Avenue in Carson. And we look rather relaxed because we are relaxed. And we look a little tired because we are tired, because it is late. And unfortunately, Roger and I did not have the time to get together for a longer period of time and under better circumstances, because he only has 24 hours here, and his time is just about up. He has to get some sleep before he gets on his long journey back to Northern California and then back to
New York,
to the East Coast of New York State. So, in closing, we're going to say a word of prayer to end our tape, and wish everyone who looks at this tape the best of Christ, and read this book and get closer to the Lord. Father, would you say a short prayer for us?
Father in heaven, we thank thee in the name of the Lord Jesus for the joys of thy salvation, for the power of thy love that has blessed our lives and will bless it as the days goes on through our pilgrimage through the land of the enemy. We pray, Father, for our young people, for those who are in the valley of decision, that the joys of thy salvation, eternal redemption, may bless their being. And by the great plan of redemption, the merits of the blood of Christ and Calvary, be saved in thy eternal kingdom, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Roger, for this very interesting get-together.
It was nice being with you.